flying is a disease for which there is no known cure.
In 1905, I watched Lincoln Beachey at the Lewis and Clark Fair fly the dirigible, and he was a young kid who was only 18 years old at that time. The first one that I really saw fly was 1910. That was right here in Portland. Charles K. Hamilton, together with Eugene B. Ely, were teams that was organized by the Glenn Curtis factory. They were demonstrators that demonstrated the Curtis products all over the country in the form of exhibition flying. All those airplanes at that time were trucked in, dismantled, assembled, flown, and dismantled, and transported to the next designation by truck. Cy Christopherson, I helped build his airplane in the latter part of 1910 and in 1911, and in 1912 is the same airplane that he used to fly off the roof of the Malama Hotel. These airplanes were built out of spruce and bamboo, wires and turnbuckles and muslin. And it's not like the type of airplane that is built today. Well, the OH-2, that was the same engine that was used in the motorcycle, the eight-cylinder motorcycle that Glenn Curtis broke the speed record at Daytona Beach with. That was in 1910, I believe. At that time, I can tell you exactly what it cost. $3,850. At that time, yes. I know it took Cy at the time that we were building his ship, starting in the fall of 1910 and all through of 1911, and we installed that engine in the spring of 1912 when he got it, and just a few months after that is when he flew off the roof of the Malo Motel in June. Mm-hmm. It was dismantled in pieces and hauled up to the top on a platform that was built on top of the roof. And I happened to be on the roof at that time. There was around 35 people on the roof, but there was thousands down on the streets watching for that event because it was advertised as part of the Rose Festival feature events. A lot of wingspread that those airplanes had at that time, and the ship only weighing 860 total pounds with a lot of surface, why, the weight per square foot was very little. So it didn't take very much power for it to get off and much of a runway to get off, and it got off less than 100 feet. And he flew to Vancouver, landed at the old barracks grounds there, took 12 minutes to fly from the roof of the Malama Hotel to land at the barracks. I did a lot of wing walking in the early days for 5 years, and right after the First World War, an exhibition flying at different fairs all up and down the coast. I didn't consider that anything phenomenal, anything that was outstanding, because I've been pretty athletic all my life. If the weather is nice and calm and air was fairly heavy, we would do it a lot of times 400 and 500 feet off the ground. No parachute or safety device of any kind, because that was in your way. When the two ships got real close together, not more than about 5 feet apart, where you could grab the wing skid of the upper ship and the pilot from the lower ship could see that you're already safe on the upper ship, and he would peel out. Mm-hmm. And the pilot of the upper ship, being that he was sitting in back of the rear cockpit, he could look out and see that you were safely anchored on the wing skid. You've got to give the pilots 75% of the credit, because, hell, I could teach a damn monkey to do the same thing that I was doing. And you wouldn't have to feed him nothing but peanuts, and he would go through the same thing with a bag full of peanuts. I consider myself just a plain damn fool looking at it now. But I made a lot of money during my time, which I consider a lot of money. One season, my share was $13,800 for 4 months. I always had a lot of confidence in myself, a lot of confidence in the pilots, and I never went to the extremes. I would study all these stunts beforehand in my mind, what I was capable of doing under the conditions. So I figured that I didn't really go out to the extremes.